unmute yourself.
Abhishek, can you make me co-host?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am, I'm just doing it right away.
We had some issue in the morning. Okay, I'm going live on Facebook, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you can start the...
Can we just check my PowerPoint?
Sir, just one second, I'll just meet everyone on Facebook. On
Zoom. Yeah, all good, all good. कुछ कुछ हुआ तो मैं SOS कॉल करूंगी ठीक है ठीक है ठीक है अगर कुछ हुआ तभी
Good evening, everyone. I'm so sorry for the delay. I'm Dr. Abhishek Lulla, and on behalf of Council for Ayurveda Research and Ayurvedya Anusandhan Abhiyan Foundation, I would like to welcome you all to day two of the wonderful Ayurveda Day celebration. And today we have with us, we are extremely privileged and honored to have with us Professor S.C. Lakhotia, sir. And before I invite, sir, I would just want to tell you a little bit about our organization. Our organization, Council for Ayurveda Research, was started by Dr. Pratibha ji. And it was started with the vision to promote and establish Ayurveda as an evidence-based health science globally. Our mission is to encourage, educate, and facilitate basic clinical and interdisciplinary research in Ayurveda. We are a non-profit organization, both in the US and India. And if you do want to become a founding donor or a donor and a part of the organization, please do visit our website, which is ayurvedaresearchusa.org. And we would love to have you as a member. As a member, there are a lot of privileges, which I explain on the website. So coming to today's topic, we are extremely honored to have Professor S.C. Lakhotia, sir, who is engaged nearly for 55 years in studying gene expression and its regulation, a replication in chromosome, cell stress response, and significance of non-coding RNAs, mostly using the Drosophila model system. Nearly all his research work has been carried out in India. His work in the late 1960s established the cellular autonomy of hyperactivity of the single X chromosome to achieve dose compensation. He was one of the first in the 1970s to demonstrate active transcription. His group established the temporal order of replication of independent replication units in different cell types of Drosophila and revealed the existence of two classes in active replicons in Drosophila. His groups made a significant contribution to a cell a stress biology by showing differential expression of some of the major heat shock proteins in different cell types in Drosophila. His recent contribution to Ayurvedic biology using the fly model has proved a new stimulus to active research directed to understanding cellular and molecular mechanisms of actions in Ayurvedic rasayanas and other formulations. Professor Lakhotia leads by personal example. He is a strong votary of promoting high quality research journals published in India. He has written many articles and has organized discussion meetings on these studies and issues related to the quality of higher education in our country. In recognition to his contribution in research and education, he has received many awards and recognitions, including a fellowship of the Three Science. He is an INSA Young Science Medalist, and he has a lot of contribution. I can go on speaking about him for an hours and hours, but I'm sure that you all want to listen to him. At last, I just want to say that he's also associated with the zoology department of Banaras Hindu University as a lifelong distinguished professor. And with this, with a few words, I would like to heartily welcome Dr. Lakotia, sir, to give his today's talk.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen and let's see if it works all right. Well, you'll have to enable my screen sharing.
Yes, sir, I'll just do it right now. Sir, it's enabled, sir.
Well, I'm still getting the message that host disabled participant screen sharing. You have to change it from participant to speaker.
Sir, just one second. I'm sorry for the disturbance. Just give me a minute.
Abhishek, I'll handle this. Just give me 1 minute. Lakotia ji, please try now.
Okay. All right. Now, can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
All right. I make it full screen. Is that fine? Full screen?
Perfect.
Okay, good. I am very happy to be part of this lecture series, and I thank Dr. Pratibha Shah and the Council for Adjunctive Research in India for having organized this and asked me to talk about something that I feel strongly about, that how do we take Ayurveda forward. And so I'll straight away go to my presentation. Now, before I go to this, I must make a disclaimer that I'm a basic researcher who is interested in genetics and gene expression using fruit fly as the model system. I have no formal training in Ayurveda, and that's one of the limitations that I may have. My actual research and interest in Ayurveda started early in this millennium when Professor M.S. Vaidyanathan, I'm very happy that he's also listening to this talk, with remarkable support from nuclear scientist Dr. R.C. Dhambaram, the then principal scientific advisor to Government of India. When they initiated the concept of Ayurvedic biology, that's where I got involved in actively in Ayurvedic research. And so my statements, I must clarify, are based on a ringside view because I'm not a basically trained. And so what I've learned is during these last 14, 15 years of interaction and learning this. But I'm an admirer of this ancient knowledge. And therefore, I will express what I think we can and we should do to bring Ayurveda to a real healthcare system, very effective healthcare system. So with that, I should say that yes, we had ancient India, there were great scholars, the great books in Ayurveda like Susrut Samhita, knowledge. And so we have these great books, but are we equivalent to what they had created? And that's where my feeling is that present state is depressing, and like many of the things in India, Ayurveda has also suffered. Why had this happened? The healthcare system, we had great scholars in ancient India, but where are we today? And I make a simple statement, we are where Macaulay wanted us to take us. This is something we need to worry about. Unfortunately, intellectuals in India are largely partitioned two groups, believers in Western philosophies and approaches, and the pro-Indian faithfuls who like to follow ancient wisdom without any question. And that's the point that we need to think about. Ayurveda has also suffered, negated by those trained in modern medicine, but faithfully followed by Ayurvedic practitioners and common man, which is good. But because it is without any serious attempt to re-examine its old principles and practices in light of contemporary knowledge, that's where things have gone bad. And Yes, we can claim that our ancients were great, but we cannot continue to feel ourselves glorified because our ancient sages were great. We need to have our own shine and glory. Then only what it will be good for Ayurveda and any traditional thing. Now, I'm just going to quote some of about the sad state, like Kaviraj Gannath Sen in 1916, when he came to Banaras for the inauguration for the foundation of BHU, he gave this talk, and I'm quoting from part of this talk. Whatever may have been the past glory of Ayurveda, it would be self-deception on our part to think that we still sit on a high pedestal. The fact is, unfortunately, it's just the other way. The number of Ayurvedic physicians in India is legion, but soundly educated exponents of the ancient system are not yet numerous. We must make good the losses we have already sustained. That's for the 1916. In 1946, Mahatma Gandhi also wrote something about Ayurveda. They do no research, work, and it is because of their greed and mental laziness that the science of Ayurveda is at low ebb. I have always blamed the Veds' apathy in the matter of real research. The top ones are busy making money. The others are too ignorant to do so or are easily satisfied with what they find in the orthodox Ayurvedic books. I'm sorry for this view. I come to it in spite of my great regard for the Ayurvedic system and the Yunani, which are suited to the soil. This was his article in Harijan 1946. Unfortunately, these observations remain largely valid even now. And that's where we need to think about how do we reverse the situation. So Ayurveda's current perspective is that we do not know on what basis, what detailed procedures and specifications Charak, Sushruta and others developed the Ayurvedic formulations and practices. We have no idea what kind of study they did, what kind of experiments they did, but the outcome of what they did is available with us, and largely, I believe, in the form that they have written it. And we will it is unlikely that we will ever know how did they discover these processes, how did they come to these conclusions, these practices. And therefore, we need to rediscover and understand Ayurveda's principles and assess its efficacy with an unbiased approach. Ayurvedic biology, as I said earlier, catalyzed by Jordi Furso, Professor M.S. Rangarajan and Professor R. Chidambaram, promotes this. Basically, and this is what I had written way back, that we need inter-basic science studies. Now, yes, old practice is very good. There's a common saying that old is gold, but it may not always be gold. But even if it is gold, gold also needs cleansing to shine. And I think that's what we need to do with Ayurveda. Science and technology and healthcare system in ancient India were far ahead of the rest of the world. There's no question about it. However, those principles and practices cannot and should not be accepted as such just because of the antiquity. That's an important point in my view. In order to take advantage of the wisdom underlying the S&T in ancient treaties, we must dispassionately examine them in light of the current understanding of principles and processes of life and other natural sciences. And this is what Ayurvedic biology aims to distinguish myths from facts and to know not only what Ayurvedic practices do, but also how they do this. And so Ayurvedic biology basically, to re-emphasize again, to re-examine and understand the diverse Ayurvedic philosophies, practices, and formulations in light of our current understanding of nature, materials, and biological systems, to provide experimental rational basis and thus separate facts from myths so that Ayurveda can be rejuvenated. Because that's important for our healthcare system now. We need to have some such systems which are holistic and which can be really experiment, experience, and experimental based, evidence-based. And that's where we joined in with our objective was unbiased inquiry into efficacy and mechanism of actions, molecular, cellular, and organ levels of traditional formulations. We established fly model, the Drosophila model for such studies. And I will not talk about much of my research as such, but just to give you a flair, we first established that yes, Amlakira Sayan and the residue that we, two of us, formula that we examined, that they do have similar effects in the Drosophila model as they are supposed to be in the human system. Then this was something very exciting. that Ayurvedic Amrita Rasayan and Rasa Sindhu suppress neurodegeneration by model. This was very interesting that Huntington's and Alzheimer's diseases were substantially suppressed. We have models where we can produce these kinds of exactly same symptoms as in humans and fly models, and then we can see whether these are suppressed or not. And this was very convincing. Then we could also show that both these formulations suppress cell death, programmed cell death, which is induced, but not developmental programs of death. And this is very important that because causing cell death inhibition can be serious, but they are causing only the one that is induced because of some damage, but not what happened during normal course of development. And Amrita Rasayan promoted improved stress tolerance. Stress could be of temperature, of starvation, or oxidative stress, and Amrita Rasayan protected them, but not Rasa Sindhu. And so then when we, the first thing, just a little bit that we standard the dose, and we, one important point was that mercury in Rasa Sindhu had no toxic effect. Now this is important. It had to be properly processed. If it is not processed, it does have toxic effect. And that's a point that Ayurveda must keep in mind, that processing is very important. Then this point that the Huntington's, or we use three different models of polyglutamine disorders and Alzheimer's disease in Drosophila, and both Amrita Rasayan or Rasa Sindhu, when given to flies, to these larvae, through the food, they suppress neurodegeneration, but had no side effect, and that was very encouraging. What we did found was that they, at the molecular level, they enhance the levels of heterogeneous RNA binding proteins, which are critical roles in RNA processing. The histone acetyltransferase, which has very important roles in gene regulation. They improve the stability of proteins, and the toxic proteins were efficiently removed, so that cells got their protein balance in a proper way. That's what we call proteostasis. And they inhibited induced cell death, so that the cell that were damaged will not disappear or will not die. And therefore, the neural cell that also would have been damaged by these cases will not die and they'll survive. And the cells have better tolerance to cell stress. So all put together, the in spite of the expression of the toxic proteins, the cells were happy and they survived normally. And that more recently, we have done transcriptomic analysis, which are the process of finalizing for publication. But what we could see there was that the poly-Q expression, which happens in Huntington's disease, affects expression of many transcription factor genes, and therefore they have a global effect on cell activity. The ubiquitin proteasome system and autophagy pathway that remove these protein clusters and abnormal proteins are affected, and therefore the cells keep on suffering damage. But when we feed them on Amrita Rasayan or Rasa Sindhu, these pathways are improved, and the damaging proteins are cleared. The chaperone activity, the carbohydrate metabolism, energetics are restored, and therefore the cells begin to function normally. And many transcription factors and other genes whose expression is adversely affected because of poly-Q aggregates, they revert to their normal activities when the toxic aggregates are clear. And Rasa Sindhu was more effective than Amrita Rasayan. Now, this is what we saw in Drosophila. We just wanted to see whether this happens in mouse as well. And so we collaborated with Dr. Patel at the CCMB, and we found these things that both Amrita Rasayan and Rasa Sindhu in the mouse model of Alzheimer's, they did have remarkably improved functioning in their both metabolic rates, behavior, memory, and so on. So what we saw in Drosophila was not something unusual, which would happen in a mammalian model as well. And therefore, these have implications for human health. Since robust physiological state following dietary Amrita Rasayan or Rasa Sindhu in flies and mouse suggests that these rasayanas may prevent several diseases and aging conditions through better homeostasis, and thus provide for healthy aging, which is one of the important points that we talk about, the holistic care that Ayurveda can provide. And now recently we have started looking at some more major assignments in collaboration with Professor Kishore Patwardhan at our Ayurveda faculty. And what we see that some of them can provide good and effective therapy for neurodegeneration without any adverse side effects. And we have written some articles on this that can Ayurveda meet the challenge of neurodegenerative disorders, and basic research provides new insights. For example, we had no idea that these can also be suppressed in neurodegeneration. And I think this is important that as part of basic studies, we hit upon this new finding, and which may have real therapeutic applications. And I think this is where there's an urgent need for systematic clinical studies, which Ayurveda practitioners should start to follow the leads that we have obtained. Now, let me come to more philosophical part that as I look at Ayurveda, what is my take and basic principles of Ayurveda? Ancient scholars appreciated the dynamic relation between life and matter on basis of the five senses, each of which recognize object by its another quality, like senses like eyes, ear, nose, tongue, and skin, which sense different kinds of qualities. And accordingly, the five most prominently visible perceptual entities in this world were Vayu or air, Jal, Akash, Prithvi, and Tej, that's fire. And each one was, because these were the most important sensation that the human body could get, they were considered most important, and they were most all around of this. However, I think inadequate understanding of physical and chemical natures of matter at that time, maybe they had, but what we have evidence for the last 2,000-3,000 years that they did not have the kind of evidence that we have today. But this is subject to debate, but why feel that they did not have as much details as we know now. And therefore, being human mind, which we always speculate, we make hypotheses. And so by looking at analyzing what they could see, they speculated that varying combination of the five bhutas generate the various forms. And that's where the Panchamahabhut concept came into. On the other hand, systematic and careful examination and analysis of phenotypes of healthy and diseased individuals by scholars like Charak and others would have led them to define the prakriti and associate this with the material world. That why does the prakriti happen? That's what they were, they associated with the which were five bhutas, and with that's where they began to talk about tridosha and so on. And what they would have imagined was that the relative proportion of different tanmatras and thus of bhutas was believed to define the dose which would establish the prakriti of an individual. I maintain that while prakriti classification based on observable phenotypic entities, the bhuta, tanmatras, and dosas are inferences by ancient scholars on the basis of their observations and the then available understanding of the material world. And therefore, this needs to be examined again. I'll come back to this point later on about this thing. And therefore, because what we now have available with us, those great books of thousands of years old, and our present practices, which have been mostly carried by oral tradition of recitation and memorization, they might have been changes in the text. They might have been some deliberate, some random mutations. And therefore, we need to have a fresh look at basic principles of Ayurveda. And this is where many recent studies have attempted to correlate the systems and terms in the Ayurvedic literature with those used in contemporary natural sciences to reveal or claim similarity between several biological systems and processes described in classical Ayurvedic literature. For example, in recent decades, we have many studies which looked at, compared the dosha prakriti types with various physiological, immunological, genomic, epigenetic variables. We had one lecture yesterday which talked about the epigenomic correlates of the thing that can go wrong and that can cause cancer and so on. So there have been many studies of this kind. And these have been interpreted as strong evidence for the validity of Ayurveda's Tridosha concept and for considering it as the first and effective personal healthcare system, which indeed it is. But what my concern is the cough and pith prakriti, as we talk about this, depend more on the morphological, physiological parameters, which are subjective, which are not quantitative, which are not very well defined, and therefore they can lead to some confusion. And that's where we need the extensive and intensely collaborative experimental studies to define them in much more precise pattern, with precise parameters. And now the other thing is that there have been many, many papers in recent years, even 30 years ago and so on, which have been claiming that what has been talked about Pancha Mahabhuta and the quantum physics and quantum mechanics and the mathematics, there's a tremendous correlation. Now, this is where my worry comes in. When one looks at these in more detail, very careful scrutiny of the article thinks that there's no hardcore evidence for such correlations. See, we can find some similar terms. I may give a very simple analogy. We all know that in the current era of science, Newton was who discovered gravitation. We can talk about ancient time, people knew about gravitation, but in the modern science, we claim that Newton talked about gravity and the forces, laws of motion, and so on and so forth. And it is these laws which provide for all the space exploration, all our machines and so on are dependent upon these laws. Now, so they all have their basis in what Newton described. But can we say that Newton knew how to make a spacecraft? Perhaps no. Newton only knew that evidence, but that cannot go that Newton knew about how the spacecraft will fly and how they will happen. Same way, when our ancient scholars talked about something, we cannot and we must not take everything as it was. Everything in science, every knowledge, even otherwise, keeps on changing. That change is eternal, and we must keep that in mind, that we cannot just go literally by what is written in some ancient book, and therefore that's valid, as has been practiced for thousands of years, and therefore there need to change. I think this is where one important point that I would like to make, that we need to look unbiased way at what we can do now. And that's where I say that we need unbiased research in Ayurveda. We need to rediscover, understand, modify, and reinterpret the principles of Ayurveda in current perspective with an unbiased approach. And so I'm listing something that I think we need to do. In-depth and unbiased studies of ancient texts in synergy with scientific experimental studies. Now, ancient texts need to be read in synergy with experimental studies. And this needs participation of actual practitioners of Ayurveda who know what it is, linguists who can understand the language of Sanskrit and other in which the classical texts exist, and experimental scientists and medical doctors with expertise in fields like plant taxonomy, plant physiology, human physiology, cell and molecular biology, chemistry, material sciences, modern medicines, etc. All of them need to work as a team to find out what exactly Ayurvedic principles, Ayurvedic materials, Ayurvedic formulations, what they are, how they work, and so on. Similarly, when we talk about this Ayurvedic rasayana, we need to understand about mechanical biological actions, how the rasayanas work, how the bhasmas work, how the asas work, what is the mechanism. And that will require a variety of model systems on which we can do. And I think now people are using the Drosophila was one, we are using the worm, people are using fish, people are doing mouse. So all the different model systems can be examined before we come to the human system to understand the basic biological actions of Ayurvedic formulations. Why has such detailed procedures provided for the preparation? Why rasayanas have to be processed in certain manner, each one in a different way? Each bhasma has to have a specific processing. Why is that simply hierarchical, or it has a certain basis? We need to examine that. And then, why are so many different anupana provided? Why sometimes you take with milk, sometimes with honey, sometimes with ghee, sometimes with water? What difference does it make? We need to understand that instead of just going because it is stated, so we do it. We need to know why and how does it work. And now, this is one point which I'll come back again. The search for active principles is not in conformity with Ayurveda. I think Ayurveda is a holistic thing, not individual active principle. We need to have precise identity of raw materials and preparatory procedures and quality control. Quality control is one of the, I think, biggest issue that Ayurveda and most traditional medicines face today. Modern medicine, I'm not going to talk about, there also issues of quality control are there. But in traditional medicine, it's much more. We need unequal identities of the various herbs and the parts which come in traditional Ayurvedic literature, and that's where we need plant taxonomists, plant physiologists who can understand, identify, and make sure that we are using the right kind of components that we need. We need to understand seasonal geographic effects on the efficacies. Amla grown at one time of the year versus another time of the year, why should they differ? I think we need to define that. Well, demand plus and quality control. The quality control is a serious damaging issue. Because I can share some of my personal experience also during this last 15, 16 years, that some of the commercial brands could be damaging, actually killing the flies. Okay, maybe humans may not be killed, but they will also suffer something. But these are popular brands which are being sold without any question because there's no way quality control. And batch-to-batch variation, the company-to-company variation. This needs to be ensured if you really want to have a public good in mind, not just money-making, which unfortunately many of these commercial houses are engaged in. We need to check on that. And that's where I think a biological quality control, I say, for example, that if we can define that these rosinant have this kind of effect in a given model, then that can be a benchmark for quality control. That every time there's something new, that when tested, does it give you the standard response or it doesn't give you standard response? Because of the multi-component of these products, chemical analysis will not be always possible and may not be always accurate. What is important is the biological effect. If we can use that as a parameter for quality, that will be much more useful. Then Panchakarma has become so popular, but again, what is real, what are modifications, whether those modifications are good or not. But more than that, we need to understand physiological and immunological effects of the diverse procedures. Why, what kind of changes they bring about? Role of epigenetics in these procedures, that before and after, what kind of epigenetic changes, gene regulatory processes, how do they change, how in relation to the state of the individual, young or old and so on, how will each therapy have an effect? We need to examine them systematically. Then we need to examine the dosha concept in relation to genomics, epigenomics, so that we can identify the prakriti types much more definitively. We need to define precisely and quantitatively which kind of genomic properties, which kind of epigenomic properties and others are associated with each of the prakriti types. I think some studies have been done, but we need much more extensive or much more larger groups. And again, we should understand that different races and different communities will have different signatures, and these need to be defined. And that's what how we coded the concept of Watfith and Cuff with contemporary knowledge of biology and redefined them in current vocabulary instead of some kind of morphological and some physiological parameters which are currently used. They are not enough. We need much more precise and definitive ways of doing this. Then something very exciting that has happened in the last two decades where I've been very excited because I'm working on non-coding RNA for the last 40, 45 years, even before they were, while they were all considered selfish and junk, I never believed in that. And now we know that there are 60, 70, 80,000 of different kinds of non-coding RNA. We talk about protein coding is only 24,000 in humans or 22,000 in humans, but the non-coding RNAs are multiples of these numbers. And we are now beginning to realize that they have tremendous role in regulating these protein coding genes, when will they function, how will they function, what consequences will have. So the entire network, this we need to bring into understand prakriti. How does the, which RNA, which doesn't make a protein and therefore has been ignored so far. But I think now we need to take into consideration what role they may have in defining prakriti. Because this is part of epigenetics now, and that must be kept in mind. And so how do we define genetic, epigenetic, physiological, metabolic, and now microbial correlates of the Dosha concept? Because microbiome has also become, in modern science, very important. Now, then, the same way we can ask what kind of training we need to provide to the Ayurveda practitioners, the young ones. They must learn fundamentals of Ayurveda, they must learn the holistic principles of Ayurveda, but in addition, they should also learn basics of contemporary biology, including cell biology, genetic, germ biology, biochemistry, physiology, and evolution, so that they can understand our body in a much better way than the traditional knowledge provides them. They must learn basics of material sciences so that the elaborate processing of rasayana dhasma that happens, why is that done? Can that be modified? Or is that necessary or just a ritual? I think that this we need to sort out. They must learn contemporary diagnostic procedures so that they can make use of the basis of the modern facility that we have available, which are remarkably precise. They may have their own side effect, but that's where a good dialogue between the practitioners and the diagnostics people will help understand what it means. And most importantly, they should not be trained as dogmatic followers. I think this has been the, to my mind, biggest damage is the dogma that we have been following about Ayurveda. Then the active principle. You see, today what has happened is anything herbal is called Ayurvedic. I think this is wrong. Ayurveda has a defined component, defined processes, defined compounds, formulations. Anything that is herbal doesn't automatically become Ayurvedic. But more important is, if we look at history, modern medicine is based on identified significant components in the various herbs that have been that have clinical action. And they identified the chemical, started synthesizing, and that's what became the modern medicine because of the reductionist approach of molecular biology, which has subsequently now led to identify the active principle in various herbal and Ayurvedic formulations so that we can now develop targeted drugs, we can chemically synthesize them, so that we say we have target drug. But I think this is where things are going wrong because we are forgetting that biological system is not an individual target. Biological system is a very complex network. You hit something here, it may have long-range repercussions. And that's where Ayurvedic philosophy is much, much better, but we need to understand that. And so search for Ayurvedic active principle is not in conformity with the holistic and interactions actions of Ayurvedic formulations. And every herbal profession is not necessarily Ayurvedic. I think this we must keep in mind while we talk about anybody now saying, okay, they are using herbal and therefore it's Ayurvedic. I think that is, especially I've seen many papers in recent times of pandemic that everybody is claiming everything Ayurvedic, which is really not true. And we need to be careful about it. The mutual skepticism that exists between traditional and modern medicine has to be sorted out. Ayurvedic practitioners limited by lack of exposure to or training in contemporary principles of biology and dogmatically faithful to the philosophies and principles of human body organization enunciated thousands of years ago. This is one reason why Ayurvedic principles remain isolated from modern science and modern medicine people. They have their own limitation. They are trained in reductionist and experimental approach. Therefore, they are not able to appreciate the holistic principles of Ayurveda. They are unable to coordinate the principles and philosophies followed in traditional healthcare system with current experimentally variable concepts. But it's not that they are not reconcilable. It's only a question of mindset that we need to change, and that will bring in the integration that we talk about it. Practitioners of Ayurveda need to come out of the shell, while practitioners of modern science and medicine need to appreciate the holistic philosophy. This is one important point that we need to work out and make sure that both sides begin to appreciate and understand what it means. There's a strong need to correlate different languages and philosophies to find and understand the commonalities. The philosophical concept of Panchamahabhut is neither experimentally verifiable nor compatible with our current knowledge of living and non-living entities. And this is something I personally strongly feel about, that we need to change our ways we describe life processes, we understand biological systems. And therefore, such concepts, because they are of historical importance, they should be learned only as historical views, not as dogmatic views, that this is the basis. I think that that's where my personal perception is, we need to change that. And this I've discussed in some of my papers. So we need to have a fresh look at principles of Ayurveda. Now, I'm conscious that the Ayurvedic community may not like some of my statements, especially because I'm not formally trained in Ayurveda. This is, I'm conscious about that. If I question Panchamahabhut, many eyebrows will be raised up because this is something considered sacrosanct in Ayurveda, but I think we need to look at it. And I am convinced that I'm not raising the such views opposite to what is philosophy. And in search to these no great ancient scholars who established Ayurveda, they had tremendous learning, and to support my way, I quote from Charak, where he said, "The science of life shall never attain finality. Therefore, humility and relentless industry should characterize your endeavor and approach to knowledge. The entire world consists of teachers for the wise and enemies for the fools. Therefore, knowledge conducive to health, longevity, fame, and excellence coming from even an unknown source should be received, assimilated, and neutralized with awareness." And that's what I mean. That if me and others are raising such voices, they should not be just brushed aside. Maybe we are wrong. Maybe we have not understood the philosophy. But let this be discussed. Let this be examined experimentally, and so that the treatment, the patient who is the ultimate beneficiary of the whole system, doesn't suffer because we start with a wrong hypothesis or wrong base. And therefore, the best parts of each healthcare system need to be integrated. The mutual suspicion between practitioners of modern and traditional healthcare systems need to be discarded, since the larger objective in each case is to alleviate human suffering. That's what all medical system ultimate objective is same. So if ultimate objective is same, I am sure there are paths that can lead and provide their individual energies in combination. And so then I will conclude here with the this Yajurveda philosophy, Pashyama Shraddhaya Shatam, Jivyama Shraddhaya Shatam, Shrinayam Shraddhaya Shatam, Prabhuvam Shraddhaya Shatam, Adina Sham Shraddhaya Shatam, Bhuvinsha Shraddhaya Shatam. This is our ultimate desire, and that's where healthy life, as is visualized, as is promised by Ayurveda, can be fulfilled if we understand Ayurveda in its holistic manner, in a rational, besides experience, evidence, experimental evidence, good understanding is necessary. So I thank the Science and Ayurveda Initiative, which made it possible for me to take these studies on the fly model and for listening. But the work in my lab was initially supported by Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor of the Government of India on the Science and Ayurveda, and currently supported by the Science and Engineering Research Board. And anybody who wants to read more about what I've been talking about, not only my research, but also in Ayurveda, all my papers on my research get placed. I thank you all, and we'll be happy to take any question that you may have.
Thank you so much, sir, for very interactive. And this was like a first-hand information on your research. And I would like to highlight a few aspects from your presentation that you started with Amal Ki Rasayan. And in Bhavaprakash Samhita, Amal Ki is considered as Vayastha, Amruta Phala. And It talks about regenerative properties. It is almost similar to Haritaki, but Amalki is somewhere more restorative in nature, and that you highlighted well with various approaches from Ayurvedic biology. You also highlighted about cell biology and material science, and how biological quality key indicators needs to be used in various pharmaceutical setups. So I think that is also very important to note, because many companies are coming up claiming it to be herbal, but as you mentioned, it need not be Ayurvedic all the time. So herbal is not all the time equals to Ayurveda, and active principle is not all the time equals to the Ayurvedic medicines. So we are talking about holistic approach, and today you are really putting a new light in terms of Ayurvedic biology with your experiences. Thank you so much for your input, sir. And I hope this will give a new direction of researches in terms of clinical research, as well as in terms of basic researches in Ayurveda. I would like to invite Dr. Pratibha ma'am for her inputs on your speech. Over to you, Dr. Pratibha ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm just trying to get Dr. Lakhotia, sir, can you, possible to stop sharing the screen?
Yes, I will do that. I'm just trying to figure out where do I do that.
Okay, maybe
a second.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Pranita. And thank you. to Dr. Lakhotia for a very enlightening lecture thing. I think I see Dr. Kishore here. So with your permission, I think I would like to invite his comments.
Yeah.
Dr. Kishore?
Yeah, hello. It was great to listen to Professor Lakhotia, sir. He has been my indirect mentor since long. I have been following his work in Banaras Hindu University. And one of my students is also working with him. And I concur with what he's in most of the aspects of current system of Ayurvedic education and also the current system of biological like standardization of herbs and herbal preparations and so on. So what he suggests, he has been suggesting throughout, is that we need to bring in more and more science into Ayurveda. Otherwise, this the line that separates Ayurveda and science should be rather we should try to diminish this distance between the two, and that is the only way of going ahead with further research and also further mutual give and take can take place only when this distance diminishes. This is what he has been saying, and I strongly believe in whatever he has been saying, and it was wonderful to listen to his lecture. Yeah, this is what I would like to say at this point of time. Yeah, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. So Dr. Lakhotia ji, thank you so much for a very thought-provoking lecture.
I hope it provokes enough.
Yes. So I was thinking that I wanted to ask you that after 2013, was there any further work done on the Rasa Sindoor Amalaki interventions?
Yes, that's what I was saying, that we have done the transcriptomic analysis now. And I'm sharing this with many others, and several labs are trying this on different diseases and so on. The publications have not come out. You see, one of the problem, I think, is the quality control. We ourselves are now stuck with this. We have our sequencing data, but then when we get the present batch of Rasa Sindoor, it's not working as effectively. And so I'm holding on. Now, and that's where my worry about the quality control comes in, that unless the products are really maintained, one batch works, next batch doesn't work. Now, okay, experiments, we can wait, but what are the patients? And I think this is something that we need to worry about. Rasa Sindoor, when I buy from several of the pharmaceutical companies, they each one looks different. They're not similar. And that's where I think an important, a very serious issue for Ayurveda is the quality control. What is being marketed, what is being provided, that needs to be seriously examined and standardized. And that's where we are also kind of on hold right now. In publishing further, unless we become absolutely sure, because we are trying to understand the mechanism, that what exactly, how does Rasa Sindoor, for example, mercury sulfide will act upon the polyQ aggregates and have similar action, which is done by amlicarasan. Amlicarasan, we can talk about it, that multiple molecules, multiple small molecules which can work, but Rasa Sindoor has just mercury and sulfur. How do they act upon? And that's where we did transcriptome analysis, we did proteomic analysis, but we are holding the results from publication till we become completely sure that yes, we can reproducibly see this again and again. It's expensive, time consuming, but we have to have that patience.
Yes.
So I'm sorry, I can't give you a very definitive evidence that this is what we are going further, but we are moving ahead, and I hope we get these from Ayurveda Shala Kottika, and I've been talking to them even today. And they said they are going to prepare fresh batches exactly as they were doing it earlier, and then we'll see it again. So it may be some time before we come with some definitive answer.
No, I think that's a very key issue, that especially in Rasa Shastra, because the Rashastra, I am a Rashastri, and Rashastra preparations take prolonged processes, actually, yes. And with very small variation in the technique, in the procedure, can result in a different print of that particular product, which is an inherent issue with any biological intervention, organic, multi-polyherbal, because even in Ras Sindoor, there is a lot of bhavana that goes on in the preparation. So I think a little change anywhere can actually result in a different footprint of that particular product. So I think that's an inherent issue. But then we have the second layer of the quality control issue, where if you have left metallic component inside that product, that is the second layer of challenge. So I think I just wanted to summarize a few takeaways with your permission. I think all of the points that you have mentioned, especially regarding the industry, are very, very valid. The industry today in Ayurveda lacks standardization, consensus on preparation, quality control, sustainability practices. There are immense number of issues there, which I think needs to be a wedding between the people and the government. I mean, just the government cannot achieve everything. I think every institution, every industry person should own that responsibility, that if the trees are not there, what are you going to make? What are you going to sell? That's one. Second, I wanted to just comment briefly on, first of all, your work is amazing. And I think that could be a very new direction for geriatrics. And geriatrics related health issues, dementia, Alzheimer's, those kind of, those groups of neurodegenerative issues. But thirdly, I also wanted to, I feel it's my responsibility to a little bit respond to, I think what you said about the basic science, right. Some of the principles. And again, very respectfully so. I think you are churning the pot, and that's really, really good, because that is needed. I think just yesterday I was talking, we had our in our US lecture series also kick off yesterday. And in yesterday's lecture, I think this is something I actually spoke about very briefly, that in the Ayurveda world, very unfortunately, we tend to live in the reflected glory of the past. And there is a tendency to present everything in that light of glory, which at the very outset discourages scientists from engaging, because it's all flowery language, and we use of words like magic and occult and this and that. And yes, there is really a tendency to correlate everything. Everything was there in our Vedas, you know, that kind of thing. But I would like to not take that attitude into account when responding. I definitely am 100% with you that we should definitely practice objectivity as scientists, and weigh everything in light of what we know today. And that's a continuous effort, which needs to be taught even at the school and the university level. I feel the opposite is taught, that, you know, the more flowery the language, the more impact you make, the more popular you are, etc. So it's a culture. This is the word I used yesterday, but unfortunately it's a culture, and that culture needs to change. But having said that, I really do want to say that I think what you have mentioned in your paper, and then there is the publication of Body Type in Nature magazine a few years ago, that was a wonderful article where the body typing and its correlation with the genotype, etc. There was, you know, that paper, I'm not able to quote the exact details of that paper, but what I'm saying is that I think we have to, truth is somewhere always in the middle. It's neither white nor black. I think we are so conditioned in the language of science that sometimes anything else appears superfluous. However, I think some of your own work is based on the assessment parameters were probably coming from Ayurveda, where you were assessing some of the things there. So I think there is merit in exploring. I think not with the goal to relegate things to the historical past, but actually reassess them and correlate them. I mean, I'm myself very keen about that. And in my student life, I had read Gray's Anatomy, Guyton's Physiology, and whatnot. I used to guzzle those things. And I think those should be part of the curriculum, because unless you are widely educated with what we know today and what was a different kind of a metaphysical approach in those days, I think that would be the ideal case scenario, where we are able to know exactly what we know today. I mean, our learning is expanding. We just had a new publication that there is a new gland or organ that has been found, a pair of salivary glands somewhere in the base of the neck here in the pharynx region. So I think it's not that we know everything as of today. We are still learning. And even in the physiology, we're learning a lot. There used to be no cholesterol, then there was one cholesterol, then there were two cholesterols. Today, I think we know 8 cholesterols or something. So I think in every which way, we are learning a lot. So I think instead of having an aim to get rid of something that we probably are not able to correlate to what we know as modern science, I think there is merit in exploring it further. And because that template fits in some interesting way, it aligns with the complexity of human body. Because there is what we understand, we know, but we don't know, we don't know.
That's right.
So I think that broad approach in some ways has merit, because it's able to cater for what we don't know. And that 5 Mahabhuta is able to be mapped on a cell as well. So it's very, very fascinating for me, where I come from, where I am a science person, but I'm also very deeply into Ayurveda. And I think we need maybe a group of scientists to analyze and represent what we know from our ancient samhitas. So I think that was a little humble submission I wanted to make.
Can I quickly respond a little point? See, my worry about Panch Mahabhuta is there are papers which I read from quantum physicists and quantum, so-called scientists who want to correlate with electron spin types and this types and this type. I think that is pseudoscience to me. And that's doing more damage to the whole system than helping the cause of Ayurveda. And that's where I say that if something we want to forcibly explain that yes, we are modern scientists, that's wrong. That kind of pseudoscience must be stopped.
Right.
That was my major point. I couldn't get into details because obviously time is short, but I think this is quite common. Even biologists, we talk of many, many things. And as you say, knowledge is unending. And I maintain my philosophy is, if I know something, what I know is what I still do not know.
Right.
That's the way we go about.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you so much. I will let Dr. Pranita and Dr. Abhishek do the honors. I'm very sorry, but I have to leave. I have a client call that has started. So thank you so much. Very enlightening to listen to you. Dr. Pranita, Dr. Abhishek, I'm going to make you host and I'm going to sign off. Thank you so much. Thank you so much to everybody who attended.
Thank you. Thank you. Sir, there are a couple of questions. If you permit, can we take them?
Yes, please. Yeah.
So there is one question that are controlled clinical trials being conducted on Ayurvedic therapies and formulations?
Well, I don't think I'm the right person to answer this. I'm not aware of any formal clinical trials. I would like this to happen. I've been suggesting to some Ayurvedic practitioners that they can do clinical trials, but I'm not aware of any that has started based on what we have found.
Okay, sir. Yeah. And there is one more question from Dr. Hina Bhatt. She wanted to know what are the ways that Ayurvedic doctors and researchers can receive the required updated knowledge in contemporary fields so that they can actually talk in the same language.
Yes, well, one is attending talks, attending lectures, reading oneself, meeting, talking with scientists, talking with people who are involved in this. You see, it's a mutual process. I should be receptive, they should be receptive, then only we can talk. Yes.
As you rightly put up, that we need to come together so that we can bridge the gap. And it's
basically, it's because of interaction that I could do and I could read something.
Yeah, definitely, sir. And integrative approach, like you mentioned, is very much crucial today in current scenario. Like understanding both the languages in terms of research terminology is very crucial because that will be the common language we speak. And now we need to decode the basic principles, physiological principles, as well as the basic sciences into the research arena. So I definitely admire that approach which you put up forward today in the lecture. And you also highlighted about how everybody needs to come forward a step so that they can bridge the gap. So I really thank for your very much informative and inspiring talk today. And I believe many researchers will take that forward. It's extremely valuable work you have contributed to Ayurveda. Even though you are not directly from Ayurveda, it doesn't matter. You are contributing a lot, which will develop a new path for newer researchers in future. Thank you so much for being here, sir. And you really, really took this lecture series to the next level. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you all. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Namaste.
Dr. Pranita, you can announce tomorrow's lecture. Dr. Pranita, you can announce tomorrow's lecture.